Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Abha Sharma, and I am assistant professor in University College of Medical Sciences. I'll be discussing session two of this training program with you. So let's see what are our learning objectives. So in this session, we'll be talking about medical management of COVID-19 based on the severity. We'll talk about evaluation of the need of ICU and critical care. We'll talk about early identification and evaluation of complication like sepsis, acute kidney injury, coagulation abnormalities, and pneumothorax. So let's see a quick classification for COVID-19. And broadly, it is classified into mild, moderate, and severe category based on the saturation of oxygen and respiratory rate. So in mild category, we'll have the patient who have flu-like symptoms, upper respiratory tract infection symptoms like fever, cough, coryza, and their SpO2, that is saturation of oxygen, will always be more than 95%, and they will not experience any form of dyspnea. In moderate category, we'll have oxygen saturation of less than 94% on room air and a respiratory rate of more than 24 per minute. And in severe category, we'll have a saturation of oxygen of less than 90% on room air and respiratory rate of more than 24 per minute. So we have to just remember it broadly, and we have to ensure that whosoever fits into moderate to severe category gets admitted in hospital. Mild patient mostly can be managed at home if the home management classification criteria is met. So let's see, how do we approach these mild cases? So what is this home isolation criteria that we need to follow in patient with mild category? First and foremost is the availability of a caregiver. Any patient who is having a symptom of COVID-19 and was diagnosed with COVID-19, classified in mild category, need to have a caregiver at home so that whenever there is a red flag sign, that person can inform the healthcare facility and get the patient shift to a nearest healthcare facility or COVID care center. There should be a mandatory facility of self-isolation at home, and it should be there for patient as well as for other relative. If it is not available, we advise the patient of COVID-19 in mild category to get admitted himself in the hospital. And at all the time, there should be communication link between caregiver and the hospital. So there is a to-do list that we ask our patient to follow at all the time, even at the home isolation setting. So first and foremost is physical distancing from all the relatives, everybody at home. Second is to wear an indoor mask. Mask is very important. Even if you are in a room, you should wear mask so that the infection does not spread to rest of the members in the household. And third is to maintain hydration. Patient need to take care of himself in terms of hydration as well as in terms of nutritional status. So if you are at home, please drink a lot of water. Please consume a healthy diet. Then we need to monitor certain things to ensure that patient's condition is not deteriorating. And in those categories, we have temperature monitoring, oxygen saturation monitoring, which is done by a pulse oximeter and blood sugar level. At least one blood sugar level should be there, because we have all seen that blood sugars abnormalities are recorded very commonly in patients with COVID-19. So we ask the patients to record these three things at least 3 to 4 hourly in their home. And if the saturation falls below 95, we should remember that it should always be more than 94%. If it falls below that, we ask the patient to consult a doctor for the need of further change in the medical management or for hospital care. So how do we manage these patients? See, we need to remember that it is a very new disease. It's been 1.5 years for this disease, but it is still a very new disease, and drugs are still evolving. So there is the full and foremost, the foolproof treatment for these patients is only symptomatic treatment. So let's see the management part. And for first, foremost, and most bothering symptoms are fever, flu-like symptoms. So what do we do with fever? We give paracetamol, and it comes in various dosages, starting from 250 to 500 to 650. We can give it as much as 650 milligram from SOS to 4 times a day. There is also, there has been study which has proven that NSAIDs, for example, naproxen can be given twice a day, and it helps in reducing the spike of fever, which is sometime not controlled by paracetamol. But we need to remember that these kind of NSAIDs are given in patients who do not have a renal abnormality. Then for flu-like symptom, we ask the patient to take the symptomatic treatment in form of cough syrup if the patient is having any cough, MDI usages, or levocetirizine. Apart from that, the flu-like symptoms can be controlled by gargles or steam inhalation, which provide temporary relief in these symptoms. And we ask the patient to do them 2 to 3 times as per their convenience at home. Then we need to find out what are the comorbid conditions that patient is having, and we need to ensure that patient is taking the medication for all the comorbid condition for which he was being treated previous to diagnosis of this COVID-19. So for example, if patient is hypertensive or diabetic, we ask the patient to get their vital signs checked and continue the medication same as before. So let's see what are the risk factor and comorbidities which we need to pay special attention. So if anybody is more than 60 years of age, has cardiovascular disorder, for example, coronary artery disease, or recently had suffered from acute coronary syndrome, some heart failure, some cardiomyopathy is there. If the patient is having diabetes mellitus, chronic lung disease, or chronic liver disease, if the patient is obese, has an immunocompromised state, which can be malignancy, or if the patient is on some medication for his cancer, lymphoma, leukemia, HIV, if the patient is pregnant. So all these things are the risk factor, and we need to lower our threshold for admission and management in these patients. We need to monitor our vital signs more cautiously in these patients, more frequently in these patients. And if even they complain a mild discomfort in chest, or even a small amount of dyspnea, which may be not very frequent, we need to pay special attention, and we need to advise them to get hospitalized. And in these patients, we need to lower our threshold of admission also. We need to remember that systemic oral steroids are not indicated in mild patients. There are special circumstances when we advise the patient steroids, but these are not the patients. And this thing has to be individualized for each and every patient. We cannot simply prescribe systemic steroids to mild patient. We have to remember this thing. So the decision for oral systemic steroid has to be taken by a physician, and it varies from patient to patient. But we need to just remember this, that we don't give oral steroids in mild patients, at least not without a physician's consultation. Now you all need to remember these red flag signs, and whenever we see one patient, we need to explain to him about all these signs, and we need to teach him that whenever he faces any of these signs, he need to rush to the hospital. So let's see what are these signs. It can be dyspnea, which is shortness of breath. We need to tell the patient that whenever he feels that he's not able to do a normal activity, which he was able to do in first 2 or 3 days of his symptom, and now he feels that he is having some shortness of breath, he needs to rush to the hospital. Any form of chest pain is a danger sign. So he needs to get to the hospital. It may be as simple as a gastritis part, but let your doctor decide that it is not a life-threatening situation. We need to ask the patient to monitor the urine output. And whenever they face that there is some decrease in a urine output, they need to come to the hospital for evaluation. If the high-grade fever lasts for more than 5 days, then we need to suspect some secondary infection also. So we ask the patient to get to the hospital. In SpO2 monitoring, if the trend of SpO2 is falling and if there is some cyanosis that patient need, and we need to explain cyanosis to the patient. We need to ask him that whenever he feel that he is having some discoloration of oral cavity in the nail beds, he need to rush to the hospital. At any given point of time, if there is mental confusion, drowsiness, altered sensorium, altered behavior to any of the patient, we need to tell them that he should be brought to the hospital. So let's see how do we approach the moderate cases. This is the scheme which we need to follow in patient with moderate as well as in severe category patient. We need to take a detailed history of patient's current as well as the past comorbid conditions. And we need to ask about recent hospitalization or hospitalization in past and how well controlled his comorbid conditions are. We need to assess it and on detail, and then we move to the detailed examination in which we do the general physical examination and then the systemic examination of each system, but we pay more attention to the respiratory system because this disease majorly involves the respiratory system. Apart from that, we need to have a look at oral and nasal cavity of the patient and do assessment of the eyes also, because sometimes what happens, these mild patients take steroids at home and they continue to take steroids at home, or the patient of diabetes who has uncontrolled sugar and come to hospital at a later stage. So these patients may have an occurrence of mucormycosis. So we need to look for any discharge or crusting in the nasal cavity as well as chemosis or conjunctivitis like symptoms in the eyes. So we need to perform a detailed physical examination. we record the vital sign, blood pressure, heart rate, respiratory rate, temperature, SpO2 at the time of presentation, and we inquire about these signs, which patient had recorded at home or not. Then we move to the routine blood investigation, in which we do complete blood count, liver function test, kidney function test. We perform a chest X-ray, and if required, then we move to the special blood investigations. So what are the aim of management in these patients? As I have told you earlier, the main aim of management is to treat the patient symptomatically, because there is no specific drug for this disease as such. We need to ensure that patient is well hydrated and has a good nutrition. The only effective therapy in the patient in COVID-19 is oxygen support. And if timely given, it is obviously a life-saving drug. So we need to keep a target of SpO2 of 92 to 96% in normal circumstances. And if the patient is having COPD, which is chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, so in those patients, we need to have a saturation target of 88 to 92%. We need to assess the need of antibiotic coverage in each and every patient individually. We cannot simply prescribe antibiotics to all the patient. We need to assess the involvement of different systems of the patient. And if we find an evidence, or if we have a strong suspicion of the bacterial infection, then only we prescribe the patient with antibiotics. Anticoagulation is also a very important step in management of the patient with moderate to severe category. And dosages are managed according to the patient's severity status and comorbid conditions. Anti-inflammatory drugs are given in form of steroids, and it is again individualized from person to person. But yes, these are prescribed in patients with the moderate category of COVID-19. There are suggested role of immunomodulatory agents, and it will be taught to you in session 3. So I'll not talk about it right now, but yes, some are found to have some role if given at a proper time. So let's see what are the devices for oxygen delivery. So the basic minimum requirement of oxygen can be met by nasal prongs, which provide oxygen of 1 to 5 liter per minute with the FiO2 of 28 to 40%. If it is very nice, because it does not interfere with patient's oral cavity, and patient can eat or drink at any time without having removal of nasal prongs. The next best thing to know, nasal prongs to meet the basic oxygen requirement, is simple face mask, which provide oxygen saturation of 6 to 10 liters per minute with a FiO2 of 44 to 60%. Similar oxygen saturation can be provided by oxygen concentrator, but oxygen concentrator comes in different capacity. Some provide a maximum saturation of 5 liter, and some provide a maximum saturation of 10 or 15 liter. So we use them according to the saturation level, and if the patient is not improving, we move to the next mask. So next thing is the face mask with the reservoir bag, or the Venturi oxygen face mask. Face mask with the reservoir bag can provide oxygen of 10 to 15 liters per minute. And Venturi oxygen face mask provide oxygen from 4 to 15 liters per minute, depending upon the mask which is used. Basically, Venturi masks are color-coded masks, and each color represent different oxygen saturation and FiO2s. So it can vary from 60% to 95% of FiO2. I'll show you the picture in upcoming slides. Then there are, if the patient saturation does not improve on face mask with reservoir bag, we move to high flow nasal cannula, which provide oxygen from 20 liters to maximum of 60 liters per minute with a FiO2 of 100%. And it is the step where we need to involve our ICU and critical care patient. Because if patient does not improve in this step, then we may need to have a non-invasive or invasive ventilation for patient, and for which we need a critical care unit and ICU support. So what are these normal non-invasive positive pressure ventilator equipments? These are in form of CPAP or BiPAP, and if the patient does not improve on these, we move to our invasive ventilators. So let's have a look at the pictures and identify each mask or each oxygen delivery device. So the lady in the left has a mask. It is a simple face mask. And the gentleman on the right has a simple nasal cannula. The picture in the left is showing a venturi mask, and we can see the different colors, green, blue, yellow, orange, white, and red. And all of them have all of them provide a different concentration of oxygen and different FiO2. In right, we have a picture with non-rebreather mask. It is also known as NRBM. This is a setting of HFNC, high flow nasal cannula. There is a nasal cannula. There is a humidifier and a machine for the setting. And we also have the central oxygen supply port behind it. So it need to have a gas source. It has a nasal interface. It has a pressure relief valve, and it has a humidifier. It is HFNC. These are the NIV mask, that is a non-invasive ventilator mask, which are used in case of BiPAP and CPAP delivery system. These are the oxygen concentrators, which are made by different companies and has different concentration abilities. Then there is a concept of awake proning, in which we ask the patient to lie down on the belly for 30 to 120 minutes, then change the position to right side for the same amount of time, then change the position to sitting up position, and then again to left side for 30 to 120 minutes. We need to ask the patient that at least during the daytime, they need to follow this cycle, and because they cannot be following these in the night time, they should at least do it in the daytime. Secondly, we need to ask all the patient who are conscious oriented and who are on oxygen therapy to follow this exercise. So what are the criterias that need to be fulfilled in the patients before we advise them awake proning? So they need to have a normal mental status, and they should be able to self prone or change the position with minimal assistance. We need to avoid this proning in patient with hemodynamic instability or in the patient in which the close monitoring is not possible. Now let's see a few points about antibiotic therapy. So as I have told you, it should not be prescribed unless we have a clinical suspicion of bacterial infection. And if there is a strong suspicion of bacterial infection, we need to consider this empirical antibiotic therapy as per the local antibiogram of that particular healthcare facility. So we should provide a broad spectrum antibiotic, which includes either third generation cephalosporin or coamoxiclav or piperacillin with tazobactam. If we suspect some atypical organism, so we need to give the atypical coverage in form of azithromycin, doxycycline, and levofloxacin. In case of MRSA suspicion, we prescribe vancomycin, teicoplanin, and linezolid. But all these therapies should be individualized, should be given if there is a clinical suspicion of bacterial infection, for example, high-grade fever, or fever not resolving after 4 to 5 days of onset, or there is some post-discharge, burning micturition to patient, evidence of UTI, evidence of sepsis, or there is some patch in lungs, which we suspect that is more of a bacterial origin than a viral origin, or if there is any secondary infection to that already existing viral patch. So in all those condition only, we prescribe antibiotic. They should not be provided routinely. Now, let's see how should we monitor our patients and what are the things that need to be monitored in our patients. So there are some clinical monitoring parameters, which are, again, I have told you previously, saturation of oxygen, respiratory rate, blood pressure, pulse rate, urine output, or RBS. These are the basic parameters that need to be followed in all the patients who are hospitalized. We need to continuously monitor the oxygen requirement. And if the patient is maintaining on a particular concentration of oxygen, we should titrate and lower down the supply of oxygen to see that whether we can start the de-escalation process of oxygenation or not. And we should look for sign of deterioration. We should make a chart for at least these vital parameters and clinical parameters, for example, state of consciousness, grading of dyspnea, chest pain, fever. We should make a chart and we should look for sign of deterioration. So every 4 or 5 hours, we need to monitor that whether patient's status is same, improved, or deteriorated. If the status is same, we follow the treatment that we are already giving. If we see that patient's status has improved, we try to de-escalate our treatment and our oxygen delivery concentration to patient. And if the status has deteriorated, we notify that deterioration and we take step. For example, if the saturation has fallen, we'll increase the oxygen demand. If the patient's hydration status is not well, then we give some IV fluids. If patient is having issue with the blood glucose, if it is hypoglycemia, we correct it and we look for the cause. If there is hyperglycemia, we give insulin. So we need to monitor these clinical signs very judiciously in each and every patient who is admitted in hospital. Then there are some lab monitoring criteria which we need to focus. There are routine investigation like CBC, DLC, KFT, LFT, and ABG, which we need to conduct every 24 to 48 hours. And if the patient is showing any derangement in any of these parameters, we need to conduct it every 24 hours to see that Is there any improvement or deterioration in that particular lab parameter or not? There are some special investigation like CRP, D-dimer, which we need to conduct every 48 to 72 hours. There is a procalcitonin level that we can get if we are having a suspicion of sepsis. And if our patient has shown a sudden deterioration in the clinical condition, we can do IL-6 levels. Then there is radiological support, and for that we can have a chest X-ray, serial chest X-ray basically, if we want to see some improvement or some sudden deterioration which has caused the fall in the saturation. HRCT is an investigation. We not do it as frequent as we prefer doing chest X-ray, but yes, it can tell us the severity of lung involvement in patients with COVID-19. Then let's see how do we approach severe cases. So our aim of management remains the same with a little bit of modification. We need to provide a symptomatic treatment. We need to maintain the hydration status and nutritional status. We need to give the oxygen support. And in severe patients, we need to provide an immediate oxygen support. And we should initiate the oxygen therapy with minimum of 5 liter oxygen per minute. We should keep our target SpO2 of more than 90% in non-pregnant individuals and 92 to 96% in pregnant patients. Antibiotic coverage is usually given in patients with severe disease, because we almost all the time suspect that there is some secondary infection that has led to worsening of the symptoms. And because the patient has come into severe category, we suspect that patient is already having some form of immunosuppression, which has led to these kind of complications. Anticoagulation mandatory in patient with severe COVID-19 patients, and anti-inflammatory and immunomodulatory therapy is also mandatory and given. Different therapy is given in it is different in each and every patient, so decided as per patient's general condition and biochemical parameters. So we start with simple face mask and which provide oxygen from 6 to 10 liters. We move, if the oxygen saturation does not improve, we move to face mask with reservoir bag and escalate our oxygen delivery from 10 to 15 liters every 10 to 15 meters, minutes duration. If the patient saturation does not improve on face mask with the reservoir bag or venturi oxygen face mask, we move to HFNC or non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. And we involve the ICU team, and we plan for intubation if the patient's condition and saturation does not improve on HFNC or non-invasive ventilation. So these are the initial settings for non-invasive ventilation, where we have to keep a target SpO2 of 94%. We have to start with a pressure support of 5 centimeter to 15, and we can go as much as to 15 centimeter of water. We have to start with a tidal volume of 5 to 7 milliliter per kg. We have to keep a PEEP of 5 to 10 centimeter of water. FiO2 at all the time should be 0.1 to 1, and we monitor it to target the SpO2 of 94%. For HFNC, we can start our flow rate from 20 liter per minute, and we can go as high as 60 liters per minute with a FiO2 of 40%, which we can increase up to 100%. And we titrate all these settings based on respiratory rate, work of breathing, and SpO2. So let's see quickly what are the indications of intubation. So it if any time patient is having high work of breathing, patient is hemodynamically stable, unstable, and if patient is not able to tolerate the non-invasive ventilation, patient is having altered sensorium or multi-organ failure, then we may consider intubation, and we need to involve our critical care team and ICU team for this purpose. So what are the lung protective ventilation strategies that are advised by ARDS NET protocol? So we need to maintain a tidal volume of 6 mL/kg. Respiratory rate setting needs to be at 15 to 35 per minute. It should not be more than 35. We need to have a PEEP of 5 to 15 cm of water, target plateau pressure of less than 30 cm of water, and target SpO2 of 88 to 95%. And PaO2 of 55 to 80% of 80 millimeter of mercury. So let's see how can we identify the complications and what are the complications that we need to identify in patient with COVID-19. So when do we suspect sepsis? See, there are many criteria that can be addressed for evaluation of sepsis, and broadly, if I need to classify broadly, we need to see following symptoms and signs and biochemical parameter, after which we can say that yes, we are suspecting sepsis in this patient and we need to start or escalate our antibiotic therapy in these patients. So if fever is lasting more than 5 days and if it is a high grade fever, we need to suspect sepsis or any secondary infection. If there is a presence of infection which can be proven or suspected, for example, if our blood culture or urine culture has shown us some evidence, or if there is some pus discharge like I have already told you, then we have a strong suspicion of sepsis. At any given point of time, if there is a continuous decrease in platelet count or increase in TLC count more than 11,000 or a fall in TLC count of less than 4,000, we suspect sepsis. We get procalcitonin levels done, and if it is more than 0.5 microgram per liter, if lactate is more than 1 mmol/L, and then in all these scenarios, we have a strong suspicion of sepsis. In the setting of sepsis, if there is hypotension in which the systolic blood pressure falls below 90 mmHg, or fallen more than 40 mmHg from baseline, and mean arterial pressure is less than 70 mmHg, then we classify it as septic shock. When do we suspect an acute kidney injury in patient? So at any given point of time, if there is increase in serum creatinine by 0.3 mg/dL or more within 48 hours, or if there is increase in serum creatinine to 1.5 times baseline, or more within last 7 days, or if there is urine output less than 0.5 mL/kg/h for last 6 hours, then we label it as acute kidney injury. That is why the monitoring of urine output is very important in all the patients from moderate to severe category, so that we can identify and correct acute kidney injury. For sepsis in patient of COVID-19, we have a tendency to give an antibiotic in almost all the patients with severe category. But we need to remember that for acute kidney injury, if we correct the cause which is leading to acute kidney injury, we can prevent the patient to complicate the already complicated situation. So we need to hydrate the patient if the cause is dehydration. We need to remove the nephrotoxic drug if the cause is that drug which is ultimately leading to the acute kidney injury. If acute kidney injury is secondary to infection, we need to change our antibiotic therapy. And if the patient is having complication of acute kidney injury, for example, metabolic acidosis, which is not being corrected by sodium bicarbonate, or if patient is started having symptoms of uremia, which can be uremic encephalopathy, uremic gastritis, which can present as persistent vomiting, which if the patient is having uremic carditis in form of chest pain, a patient will be presenting, then we need to provide a supportive therapy in form of hemodialysis. Next are coagulation abnormalities, which we need to look for. We have seen that patient of COVID-19 can have both the type of coagulation disorder, bleeding as well as clotting. So for we need to look for both these signs. Patient can have chest pain, sudden onset of breathlessness, symptoms suggestive of stroke, for example, hemiplegia or slurring of speech or deviation of mouth. Patient may have leg swelling, which is suggestive of DVT. Patient may have sudden drop of oxygen saturation, which can be there in patient with pulmonary thromboembolism or ACS complicated with the LVF. Patient may have bleeding from various sites. Patient may have deranged PT-INR. So whenever any such thing happen, we correct that particular abnormality. If there is thrombus, we give anticoagulation. If there is bleeding, we provide the clotting factors. So when should we suspect pneumothorax? So anytime if patient complain of chest pain or shortness of breath or trauma or sudden fall in saturation or blood pressure, and at any given of point of time, if patient is having tachycardia, we can have a suspicion of pneumothorax. We need to pay special attention to the patient who are on BiPAP or CPAP therapy, because the pneumothorax that is secondary to barotrauma caused by these positive pressure devices has been a common finding in patients with the COVID-19. So we need to pay special attention to these patients, that if the patient is on BiPAP and suddenly complaining of shortness of breath, and or if there is sudden fall in SpO2, we need to suspect pneumothorax and get the patient investigated for that. We can get an X-ray done, and if nothing is visible on X-ray, we can get a CT scan done for these patients. So let's have a revision in form of MCQs. So for example, a patient comes to you, 66 years old male, who had fever, flu-like symptom for 3 days, and COVID-19 diagnosis was made at the nearby laboratory. Patient was advised home isolation. Patient is a known case of diabetes mellitus, and he monitored his RBS, which was 150 milligram of milligram per deciliter and SpO2 of 97% on room air. And he complained of shortness of breath for past 1 day. Then what should he do? A, he should stay at home. B, he should go to the hospital. Or C, he should go to the pharmacy and get some analgesic for that. Now we need to look at it from a different perspective. See, the patient is elderly. We have already talked about it, that if the patient is elderly and have some comorbidity, we need to lower down our threshold for admission. This patient may be having an acute coronary syndrome. So he should go to the hospital would be the correct answer. So B should be the correct answer. Then let's see another example. A 33-year-old male who has been diagnosed with COVID-19 and is on home isolation. Patient does not have any comorbidity. RBS is 150, saturation is 99% on room air, and patient can be given all except, so A, paracetamol, B, levocetirizine, C, steroids, D, antitussives. So the answer would be steroids. He does not need steroids, okay? Then identify this picture. So it is an NIV mask. No. Or is it a nasal cannula, or is it an NRBM, or is it a Venturi mask? So the answer is C. I'm really sorry. The answer is C. It is a non-breathing face mask. So identify this instrument. So it is a NIV mask. Now, all are indication for intubation except a SpO2 of less than 80% despite oxygen therapy, sudden deterioration of consciousness, increased work of breathing, or SpO2 of 92% on oxygen. So the answer would be D, because patient is meeting our target of SpO2 on oxygen delivery devices. So that is all. Thank you so much for your attention.